We are continuing with our topic with caption, The Believer's Walk of Grace and Faith. And today is in part 4 of this series, The Believer's Walk of Grace and Faith. We have said that grace is God's resource that has been made available to man at Christ's expense. Christ has borne the expenses. He has paid the price. And we are enjoying the benefits through the expression of God's grace. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to the world, so that the world through him might be saved. Might be saved from the wrath, might be saved from judgment. And Jesus came and paid the price with his life, with his blood, through his death, burial, and resurrection. And the whole world, salvation has been made available to the whole world, to the entire mankind. But that does not mean that all men are saved. It is only those that will put faith in Christ, the Savior, and what he has done that receives salvation. That is where grace and faith come in our walk with God. It's very important. We have also mentioned that there are usually two extremes. There is one extreme of believers that just say faith is, grace is everything. God has done everything. I don't need to do any other thing. Everything that happens is according to the will of God. It's God's will. It is good. Everything is God. No, that's not. That's an extreme dimension of faith. Not everything that happens is the will of God. That's why God said we should resist the devil, because there are some things that the enemy would organize and bring your way. So that kind of extreme grace brings a lot of passivity, makes people to be passive, and not rising up to their responsibility. Because grace provides, and faith takes. Grace has provided all things, but we must use our faith to appropriate these things, for us to personally enjoy and manifest it. Amen. Now today we are applying this very important subject in the aspect of our rest in Christ. And we are taking our text from Hebrews chapter 4. We read first of all verse 1. Hebrews chapter 4, we read verse 1. It says, let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest. You know, Jesus said in Matthew 11, he said, come unto me, all ye that weary and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. So Jesus is the rest of God. He said, let us come. He says, the promise being left us of entering into his rest. Any of you should seem to come short of it. Let's jump to verse 8 because of time. Verse 8. Verse 8 says, for if Jesus, now this Jesus here is Joshua. He's referring to Joshua because in the Hebrew tongue, Jesus also means Joshua. Joshua that took them into the land of promise in the Old Testament. It says, for if Jesus or Joshua had given them rest, if they are Joshua, taking them into the land of Canaan and giving them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? So that was not the ultimate rest. That rest, that Canaan was a physical, or in other words, a shadow of the rest that is in Christ, the kingdom of God. That when we believe in Christ, we receive Christ, we gain access into it. It's a very, very acceptable. Except a man be born again, or born of the Spirit and water, it cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Now, the rest is in Christ. So when you are born again, you come into Christ, you come into that rest. Amen? Now, next verse, verse 9. It says, there remaineth therefore a rest for the people of God. I'd like to explain that this rest is not walking, folding your hands, saying God has done. No, that is not the rest we are talking about. Now, this rest is not about doing nothing. But the rest is talking about being at rest in the knowing that God by his grace has already provided all things for you. That is the rest. You knowing that God by his grace has provided all things for you. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3, according as his divine power, he has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. See, coming into Christ, being born again, is like coming into the Garden of Eden, as we have it in Genesis, where the garden was already prepared. God anticipated everything that man would need when he created the world and had provided everything. It is not when somebody comes to the world, he needs oxygen, that God goes to provide oxygen for him. Oxygen is already there. Oxygen for 7 billion people in the world today had been provided during creation. Food that 7 billion people will need has already been provided during creation. Amen? So God does not do anything in response to our request. God has always provided all things, has already provided all things. It is not when we request. It was not when Adam requested for food that God went to provide food for him. It was not when he requested for water that God showed him water. Everything had been provided in the garden. Now that is how we should see our coming into Christ. Our coming into Christ is coming Eden means the garden of his presence. That is the garden of Eden, the garden of his presence. Coming into Christ is coming into the garden of God's presence. So all things have been provided. All that we need to live godly lives have already been provided for us by the grace of God. According as his divine power is according to his grace, God's power, the grace of God has provided all things for us. But are you enjoying all now? That is where faith comes in. Just like salvation was provided. Said, by grace are you saved? Through faith. But we, through faith, we obtain, we receive salvation. That is how all things have been provided for you as a child of God. You have, through faith, you take it. Your healing has been provided for already by the stripes of Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 24. By his own stripes, we were healed. That is, we have been healed already. God has provided for your healing already. You now receive with faith. Now that is what we've been talking. So the rest here is about the knowing that God, through his grace, has already provided all that you need. The children you need have been provided for. The house you need have been provided for. All that you need have been provided for. Praise the Lord. That should be a good news. So it is not asking, Lord, do this. It is thanking God for what he has. And then connect with your faith and receive it. Your faith in the finished works of Christ brings you to that rest. It is your faith in the finished works, what Christ has already completed and finished. That is what brings you to that rest. Amen? So you are at rest in the fact that God loves you and has provided all things for you. Since from creation, God does not create anything new after he finished creation. Bible says he rested. Now that rest does not mean that he was tired. He does not have human flesh to be tired after 6 days of creation. So he was not tired, not tiredness. He did not sleep. Bible says neither sleep nor slumber. No, so it was not sleep. No. It was the satisfaction that all he wanted to put in place had been put in place. That was what gave him rest. That was the rest he entered into. So you also enter into that rest that God has already provided all things you need for your life. Amen. It is not when you need something, God starts creating it for you. No. That is why we said in the last broadcast that your faith doesn't move God. No, your faith is rather used to appropriate what God has already provided for you to enjoy. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, already provided. Now, and many of us pray for things like peace. You say, God, give me faith. I don't have enough faith. God, give me peace. God, I need patience. No, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, it says, Galatians 5, 22 and 23, it says, but the fruit of peace, now it's already there. These are things that your born-again spirit is already is producing. These are the traits of the character traits that your born-again spirit is producing. The fruit of the spirit is love. So love already exists in your born-again spirit. Amen. Romans 5:5. God has already given us, shed abroad our hearts. It's love. That hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost which is given to us. Now, so love, joy, you already have joy. No, Lord, give me joy. No. Tell yourself, keep acknowledging that you have joy. I have the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. You have joy already. Amen. Now, we are going to now focus on peace. You don't need to pray for peace. Particularly this time that the whole world is facing some crisis and chaotic times. You don't need to forget. Peace is already inside you, in your born again spirit. All you need to do is to draw it out. It's to live in the consciousness of it, that you have peace. All you need is to acknowledge it. Praise the Lord. Now. So you have peace already. You have peace already. I was talking about the peace of God that passes all understanding. That is what you already have. Peace that no matter the chaos, no matter the crisis, nothing shakes you. You are calm inside and outside. Nothing tampers with that peace. It is in you. You need to develop it. You need to release it and walk in the reality of it. Praise the Lord. Look at that Galatians now. He said, love, joy, peace, long suffering, patience, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. He said, against such, there is no law. You know, what does this mean? Against such, there is no law. It means that there is no law as can be put in place against love. There is no law against love. There is no law that. So when you walk in love, you walk above the law. When you love, because there is no law. The law is rather for those that walk in hatred. So when you walk, it is when you walk in hatred, and then that hatred pushes you to do evil, then the law comes against you. So law is for those who walk outside of love. The same thing with joy. When you walk, there is no law against joy, but there is law against sadness. Now, if you allow sadness to overwhelm you and you commit suicide, it it is not right. There is no law against patience, but there is law against impatience. If you become impatient and go to sin to satisfy your need, the law comes against you. And that is why Paul said, writing to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 9, that the law is not made for a righteous man, for a believer that has that is born against spirit, is already loaded with patience, with love, with joy. It says the law is, again, it's not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly, because they are not walking. These traits, the character traits of the Holy Spirit, are not finding expression for them. They are not controlling their lives. So the laws are set up to control those people, to control their excesses. When they want to do something, they will remember that there is a law, that if they are caught, they will be punished for it. Praise the Lord. So that's what this scripture means. Now, let's move further. Amen. So how do we draw out this peace? The peace of God that passeth all understanding, that already exists in us. How do you release it? Now, this time that there are several things, there are all kinds of things. How do you release it? Now, quickly, let's look at the scripture. Psalm 119, verse 165. It says, great peace are they which love thy law, that is, the word of God. And nothing shall offend them, nothing shall tamper with their peace, nothing shall make them, because they love the Lord. Like the psalmist said in Psalm 1, from verse 1, he said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is the Lord of his God, and in his law doth him meditate day and night. Say, for such a man is as a tree, it's like a tree planted by the rivers of water. It shall bring forth his fruits in his season, his leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. So when you put your mind, you love the law, the word of God, it gives you peace. Fall in love with the word. And when you love the word, you will read it, you will study it, you will meditate in it, you will practice it. The word of God tells you that in several, in fact, according to Bible scholars, we have 366 words, fear not, in the Bible. Fear not, that is, be at peace, no matter the crisis. Fear not. Be at peace. That is for that. For every day there is a word telling you, don't be afraid. Relax. God is in charge. Amen. So fall in love with the word of God. And number two, keep your mind stayed on God and his word. Keep your mind stayed on God. Isaiah 26, verse 3. Keep your mind stayed on God. Keep your mind settled on God. And you know, the word of God is God. According to John 1:1, the word of God is God. Now, if we read Isaiah 26, verse 3, we read Isaiah 26. But in John 1:1, the Bible says that, you know, it was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God. So when you keep your mind, to keep your mind in God, is to keep your mind in his word, what he has told you. Amen. What he has told you. Let's go back to Isaiah 56, verse 3. It says, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, and is on the Lord, because he trusted in thee. So putting your mind on God is trusting in the Lord, trusting in God. That, for instance, he said, when he's in the midst of famine, he will provide for his children. He said, the psalmist said, I've been young, now I am old, I have not seen the righteous forsaken or his seed bread. So when Satan will want to throw thoughts at you, to trouble your mind, to make you look some other way, and take do some other things, some unlawful things to meet your needs. But you put your mind on God. And putting your mind on God is putting your mind on His word, putting your mind on His promises that He will provide for you. He will exempt you. Amen? That is that. Yes, we are facing a pandemic today, the coronavirus, COVID-19 pandemic. Believe that the word of God says in Psalm 91, it says, because you made the Lord your refuge and the Almighty your habitation, from verse 9, it says, there shall no evil befall you. Believe, put your mind on God and His word, that the evil of coronavirus shall not befall you. He said, no plague shall come near your dwelling. So the plague of coronavirus shall not come near your dwelling. But that does not mean that you should be careless. Respect what the government says. Respect what World Health Organization has said, that we should put on our mask, we should maintain social distancing and all of that. But put your mind, do all of those things, because we are not tempted, we are not also to tempt the Lord. Jesus would have fallen down from the pinnacle when Satan tempted him. But he said, no, thou shalt not tempt the Bible says, thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. So don't tempt the Lord your God. But while you do those things, you take all of those precautions, but your mind must be stayed in God and His word. That guarantees you that the plague shall not come near your dwelling. Amen. Tell that the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon you and your lot. Psalm 125 and verse 3. The rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous. And the lot means you, your family, and your properties. The pandemic will not come near anything that belongs to you. Amen. In the Old Testament, we read about Job, how that because of God's head was round about him and round about all that he had. Now, put your mind on the word of God. When you see needs come to overwhelm you, don't allow the needs to overwhelm you. Put your mind on God and put your mind on the word of God, and God will come your way. He never fails. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And then, you need to put your faith to work, release your faith. Like we said in our last broadcast, you as a child of God, as a born-again Christian, a believer in Christ, you don't lack faith. You already have faith. God and salvation gave you a measure of the faith. The same measure He gave to the apostles. He gave to you the same measure Peter had, that his shadow was healing the sick. When we are brought into contact with the shadow, they were getting healed. That same shadow, see, that same faith is in you. It's already in you. You are not trying to get it. You don't need to pray for it. All you need to do is to make it effectual. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious. He was talking to believers, which includes you, that it says, like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior. Right, like precious faith. So you already have the like precious faith that Paul, Peter, James, all of them have. That is the kind of faith, that is the same faith you have. So you don't have a faith problem. All you need to do is that faith that has already been given to you, with which you believe and God saved, you put that faith to work. You make that faith effective, effectual. That's what Paul meant when he wrote to his co-laborer, Philemon, in Philemon verse 6, Philemon is just one chapter, and verse 6.
That the communication of thy faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing that is in you in Christ Jesus. Amen. So it is you acknowledging the good things that are already in you, in your born-again spirit. Amen. Everything you need, everything that Christ is, they are already in your born-again spirit. It is you acknowledging it. So, for instance, you acknowledge that in your born again, you have, in your born again spirit, you have peace. I have peace with God. I have peace. Now, you acknowledge it by knowing it, studying from the Word of God. What God says about His peace to you. He said, the peace that He has given us, not like the kind of peace that the world gives, is kind of peace, is what He has given to us. Amen. You acknowledge it, and then you confess it, you declare it. Come to the exact knowledge. Study the Word of God to know God's peace. How do I lay hold on God's peace? How do I walk? How do I conduct myself to continue to enjoy God's peace? And then you keep confessing it. I will know that you have peace. That is acknowledging it. And that peace will become a reality in your day-to-day living. God bless you. I encourage you. I pray that whatever be the noise, whatever be the fear in town, I decree peace in your heart. The peace of God that passes all understanding will not elude you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I welcome you into the rest of God that God's grace has provided for us in Christ Jesus. Release your faith and take it. God bless you. Rest in every area of your life. In Jesus' name. Amen.